إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا ما يهدي الله فلا مضل له فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. All praise and thanks belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As such we praise Him, we thank Him, we seek His help and we seek His forgiveness. Whoever Allah guides, there's none that can misguide. Whoever He allows to go astray, there's none that can guide. And I bear witness that there's nothing worthy of our worship except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone without any partner. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a slave of Allah and His messenger and the seal and the final prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And indeed the best of speech is the speech of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and the best of guidance is that of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the worst of matters are the newly innovated ones into the deen. For every newly religious matter into Islam, it is a bid'ah, and every bid'ah is a source of misguidance, and every misguidance leads to the hellfire. A hadith which was collected by Imam Abu Dawood, rahimahullah, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was reported to have said, أَلَا إِنِّي أُوتِيتُ الْكِتَابَ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ. He said, alayhi salatu wasalam, that indeed I was given the book, أَلَا إِنِّي أُوتِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ. In another riwayah, I was given the Qur'an and something to the likeness of it along with it. So the likeness of the Quran in revelation is the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Quran is revelation. It is wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise, the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is also revelation. It is wahi from Allah azza wa jal. In the same narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, أَلَا يُوشِكُ رَجُلٌ شَبَعَانُ عَلَىٰ أَرِيكَتِهِ. He says, yet the time will come when a man will be leaning or reclining on his couch, saying, عَلَيْكُمْ بِهَذَا الْقُرْآنِ فَمَا وَجَدْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ حَلَالٍ فَأَحِلُّهُ وَمَا وَجَدْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ حَرَامٍ فَحَرِّمُوهُ. He says, stick to this Qur'an. What you find in it to be halal, then make it halal. And what you find in it to be prohibited, then treat it as prohibited. However, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us, وَإِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam كَمَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهِ. That whatever the Prophet prohibits, it is the same as exactly the same as what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibits. So because whatever the Prophet prohibits, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's not doing this out of his own opinion, out of his own accord. Rather, this is wahyi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being revealed to him. As Allah makes reference of that in Surah An-Najm, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى, that the Prophet does not speak out of his own desire. Rather, إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٍ يُوحَى, it is only revelation which has been revealed unto him. Then the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, in the same hadith which was collected by Imam Abu Dawood, he mentioned some of the prohibitions which you will not find in the Quran. And he says alayhi salatu wasalam, أَلَا لَا يَهِلُ لَكُمْ لَحْمِ الْحِمَارِ الْأَلَهْلِ وَلَا كُلُّ ذِي نَابٍ مِنَ السَّبْعِ. He says, beware, the domestic donkey is not permissible for you to consume. It is not permissible for you to eat. Yet this is not in the Quran. And he says, neither the beasts of prey with fangs. Those predators who have fangs, they are not permitted for us to consume. Yet also this is not in the Quran. And he says, وَلَا لُقَى مُعَاهِدٍ إِلَّا أَنْ يَسْتَغْنِيَ عَنْهَا صَاحِبُهَا. He says, or a lost item, which a non-Muslim with whom we have a covenant, unless he doesn't want it. If he loses something, a lost item, we are not allowed to just take it just because that person is a non-Muslim. He says, وَمَا نَزَلَ بِقَوْمٍ فَعَلَيْهِمْ يَقْرُوهُ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَقْرُوهُ فَلَهُ أَنْ يُعْقِبَهُمْ بِمِثْلِ قِرَاهُ. He says, if anyone comes to a people as a visitor or as a traveler passing by, they should host him, they should feed him. But if they don't, then he has a right to take from them something which is equivalent to what was expected in terms of feeding him. So this was narrated in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Likewise, he said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, لا ألفين أحدكم متكيا على أريكته يأتيه الأمر من أمري مما أمرت به أو نهيت عنه فيقول لا ندري ما وجدنا في كتاب الله اتبعناه. He says, let me not find one of you reclining on his couch, on his chair, when he hears something regarding which I have commanded or which I have prohibited, I have forbidden, for him to say, I don't know, I don't know. Whatever we find in the Quran, this is what we're going to follow. He said, let us not do that. This is not from the guidance. So such people are people who are looking to deny the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, despite Allah saying in the Quran himself, regarding the disbelievers, وَلَا يُحَرِّمُونَ مَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. And those disbelievers, they don't prohibit, they don't make forbidden that which Allah and Rasuluhu and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam made prohibited. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah Azza wa Jal, He has preserved for us this deen, this religion. And it is the only religion with valid, authentic sources. And this is from the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon this ummah, and we are part of that. That He preserved the Quran. Allah protected the Quran, and He preserved also the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam through those men who believed in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The same men who passed down to us the Quran are the same people who passed down the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and they conveyed it. And those are the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, the companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and then those Tabi'een and Atba'u Tabi'een, the followers of those Sahaba and the followers of those who followed the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum ajma'een. And this chain continues. So those who taught us the Quran, at the same time, they taught us the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and this was their understanding, and this they also taught us how to understand these two sources. So this is what we have available to us up to this day, walillahil hamd, and inshallah ta'ala it will remain. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He chose sincere people to convey this deen. Sincere people after the Prophet passed away alayhi salatu wasalam, people who were magnificent. They were great in their memory and precaution, to the point that we find some of them, they would make a long journey, a long trip, just to verify one hadith, one saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then if you think about it, traveling back in time, at their time, how long it took for them to make one journey, it's not like it is today, subhanAllah. So you can imagine the effort that they put in. So we're not talking about a day travel, we're talking about months of travel, just to go and confirm one hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So the effort was enormous, and they did this to preserve the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which we have access to today. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He facilitated the means for those great men. And in fact, there was even women scholars, muhaddithat, as they were known, people of hadith that preserved the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's a narration of which was collected by Imam Ahmed in his Musnad. He says that Jabir ibn Abdullah, the Sahabi of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he traveled all the way to Sham just to hear one hadith directly from that narrator who narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A hadith that he had heard before, but it wasn't sufficient for him. He wanted to go and hear it straight from that person's mouth who heard it from the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said, I did this because I was afraid either death might overtake me first or it will overtake that person. So he made it and he heard it straight from him. Likewise, we have Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, may Allah be pleased with him. He traveled from Medina all the way to Egypt to hear just one hadith from Uqba ibn Amir radiallahu anhu. So he heard it from the Sahabi, and then he traveled back to Medina again. He did not even stay in Egypt. He heard the hadith and he went back. From the Tabi'in, we have Abu Uthman al-Nahdi. He said, I wanted to hear hadith from Abu Huraira directly. So he went to Hajj because he knew that Abu Huraira would be performing Hajj. He did not go to Hajj with the intention to perform Hajj, but he did it anyway. But he went for the sole purpose of meeting Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. And he said, this was my intention. I came to see you, Abu Huraira, because he wanted to hear the hadith directly from the man who heard it from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the list goes on. And it is said, Abu Sa'id ibn Musayyib, may Allah be pleased with him as well, that he would walk days and nights seeking one hadith. We're talking about people who sought one hadith in their travels, subhanAllah. So the list goes on. All of these people, they exerted great efforts in compiling a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but some of them simply excelled over others. And this is what I want to mention, Shu'bah ibn al-Hujjaj. May Allah be pleased with him and have mercy upon him. He was known as Amir al-Mu'mineen, the leader of the believers in the hadith, because he excelled other people in his efforts, subhanAllah. And it is said about him that he traveled all over and he was known for his sharp and tough memory. Once he was in Kufa, which is in Iraq, he was searching for a narrator of a hadith and he found him, but that man told him that the sheikh that I heard it from, he is in Mecca. So Shu'bah, he traveled all the way to Mecca. And when he went to Mecca, he arrived there, he met that narrator. And that narrator said, the sheikh I heard it from, he is in Medina. So then he made his trip all the way to Medina to meet that man. Once he met that man said, the sheikh I heard it from, he is in Basra, which is back in Iraq. So he's making all this trip going around just for one hadith. And the funny part about this is that the hadith was not even sahih. So all that effort just to verify what the authenticity of the saying of the Prophet ﷺ is it true or not? This is the effort that they exerted, subhanAllah. So this goes to show us about the efforts, the juhud of these muhaddithin and how keen they were in validating, in confirming, in grading, and authenticating the sayings of the Prophet ﷺ. But nowadays, unfortunately, as the Prophet had prophesied, that there's people out there who are reclining on their chair. They're sitting on their couches on a full belly, he says, alayhi salatu wasalam, like it's nothing. He said, whatever is in the Quran, this is sufficient for us. This is what we're going to follow. We don't need the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So the people who want to cast doubts, they want to reject the sunnah by rejecting the authentically proven narrations which were from the scholars of the past, from the best of generations, which the Prophet praised them. And he said, khayrun nas, that the best of people are my generation, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. And then those who follow them, and then those who follow them. Those are the blessed generations of Islam, and they are the ones who pass down Islam as we know it today, the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, preserved and protected, as Allah says, inna anzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidun. We have revealed the dhikr, which is the Quran and the Sunnah together, because they're both revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah says, we will protect it. أَقُولُ مَا تَسْمَعُونَ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. Those people, my dear brothers and sisters, those people who want to cast doubts and reject or say that we are not in need of the sunnah because we have the Quran, these people are either the enemies of Islam or they are people who are simply ignorant and they have some shubuhat, some doubts, which the enemies of Islam have brainwashed them with. Okay, these enemies of Islam who want to misguide the Muslims and they want Muslims to abandon their deen. Otherwise, we ask the question, where do we find the five daily prayers in the Quran and the manner and how they're performed and the details of those prayers? You will not find it in the Quran. You will not find these details about the number of raka'at or how you should pray when you're a traveler. You will find none of this in the Quran. So let it be known that those people who reject the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and they don't believe in it, those people are not Muslim. Those people are not Muslim, they are in a different religion, and Islam is not their religion. And it's not strange to find people who have animosity towards Islam, that they wish to misguide the Muslims by propagating such ideas. But for us, for Muslims who are practicing the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we cannot be caught off guard. We cannot be swayed by what these people are saying and what they're spreading all over. This is in fact prophesied from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that it would happen. But we need to be knowledgeable about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we don't know this shubuhat that they try to pose, then this may be detrimental to the people's iman. It may misguide them, in fact, from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and leave Islam altogether. So it's very important that we equip ourselves with the knowledge of Allah, with the knowledge of the deen before anything else, so we know how to crush those shubuhat that the kuffar and the munafiqeen, they try to use in order to extinguish the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they will not be able to do that. They will never be able to extinguish the light of Allah, as Allah says, يُرِدُونَ لِيُطْفِئُوا نُورَ اللَّهِ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَاللَّهُ مُتِمُّ نُورِهِ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ. That they want to extinguish the light. They wanted to extinguish this deen, this Islam, with their mouth, what they're saying, what they're propagating. But Allah will complete it, even if they dislike it, even if they hate it. So have no doubt that Islam will prevail. Islam will always prevail. But we want to prevail along with it. We don't want to lag behind and be from the khasirin or the losers. We want to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, believe in this deen, following this deen, dying upon it, and meeting Allah with a bright face, yawm al-qiyamah, This is what we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. May Allah guide all of us to the correct understanding of Islam and forgive us for our shortcomings. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna tiba'a wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna ijtinaba. Allahumma atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhab an-nar. Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulubi wal-absar thabbit qulubana ala dinik. Allahumma ya musarrif al-qulubi wal-absar sarrif qulubana ala ta'atik. اللهم من أرادنا أو أراد الإسلام والمسلمين بالسوء فأشغله بنفسه وجعل تدميره في تدبيره يا قوي يا عزيز عباد الله إن الله تعالى أمركم بأمر فبدأ في بنفسه فقال جل من قال عليما إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد هذا والحمد لله رب العالمين وأقم الصلاة.